Good morning. This is a day that our God has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We welcome each one of you here this morning for worship. We're glad that you've joined us. Just a couple of announcements to highlight for you this morning. First of all, the good news, we are reopening for in-person worship March 28th. That is going to be Passion Sunday rather than Palm Sunday this year. We will also have our Holy Week services here. Monday, Thursday will be at 7 p.m. Good Friday will be at 7 p.m. Our Easter service in the cemetery, 6:30 a.m. I'm asking you to bring your own chairs along for that. And then our Easter service here in the sanctuary at 9 o'clock in the morning. We will be having communion at both of our Easter services. It's going to be good to see you all again rather than looking out at empty pews or looking at myself on the television set. It's going to be good to be back with you this morning, these next few days. Any questions about any of this, please check our Facebook page, or if that doesn't give you the answer, give our board president, Nancy Miser, a phone call, or me. We'll do our best to answer any of the questions we have, but it's going to be good to be back in worship, as in-person worship again. So let's all begin now with our invocation. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the keeper of the covenant, the source of steadfast love, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Our call to worship. Jesus was rejected by his own people. His disciples fled from him. The Father abandoned his Son to the suffering of the cross. Now the crucified and risen Lord has promised us, I am with you always. Often forsake the word and ways of the Lord to follow the world's temptations. Forgive us, Lord, and lead us in paths of righteousness. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest. Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour, and about the ninth hour Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? Lord, you were forsaken, abandoned to the suffering of the cross for our sake. We know that you will never leave us. Help us to bring comfort and hope to those in need. God hears us when we cry and draws us close in Jesus Christ. Let us return to the one who was full of compassion. Fountain of living water, pour out your mercy over us. Our sin is heavy, and we long to be free. Rebuild what we have ruined, and mend what we have torn. Wash us in your cleansing flood. Make us alive in the Spirit to follow in the way of Jesus as healers and restorers of the world you so love. Amen. Beloved, God's word never fails. The promise rests on grace by the saving love of Jesus Christ. The wisdom and power of God, your sins are forgiven and God remembers them no more. Journey in the way of Jesus. Amen. Our first reading is from the Old Testament book of Numbers, chapter 21, verses 4 through 9. They traveled from the Mount Hor along the route to the Red Sea to go around Edom. But the people grew impatient on the way. They spoke against God and against Moses and said, "Why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? There is no bread, there is no water, and we detest this miserable food." Then the Lord sent venomous snakes among them. They bit the people, and many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We sinned when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us." So Moses prayed for the people. The Lord said to Moses, "Make a snake and put it on a pole. Anyone who is bitten can look at it and live." So Moses made a bronze snake and put it up on a pole. Then when anyone was bitten by a snake and looked at the bronze snake, they lived. Here ends our first lesson this morning. Gospel is written in the Gospel according to St. John, the third chapter, verses 14 through 21. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his only one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light, because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. This is the gospel of our Lord. Grace, mercy, and peace be given unto you from Almighty God and our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. So what do you think? Is there any truth to the statement that we sometimes really, really like the darkness? And I'm not talking about literal darkness, although it's nice to fall asleep in a darkened room. And I suppose it's, well, I know this to be a fact. It's nice to leave the dining room lights dimmed a little bit so that we can't see the cobwebs up in the corner. But, you know, sometimes figurative darkness feels pretty good. When we have certain things or certain people that we would like to hide from on a regular basis, hey, darkness is a good place to do that. When we have something in our past or maybe even in our present that we hope stays hidden, darkness is an immense help in hiding our sins. When we find that there are certain people or certain kinds of people or certain things that certain people do that we really despise and really we don't want to reconcile with, darkness is a great place to keep and to nurture those feelings. Even those of us who very much want to be followers of Jesus Christ, who is the light of the world, we have those moments in which we prefer darkness than light, and in which we hide from the light so that our deeds may not be exposed. But we can emerge from the darkness into the light of Jesus Christ. Well, just for a moment, set aside those things about ourselves that we'd like to keep in the dark, keep in darkness. Think first instead about things about yourself that you would like to have brought into the light. When you are given recognition or given an award for volunteer hours you have spent quietly doing good, it is pleasant to have light shine on you at that moment. Okay, might be a little embarrassing, but it is kind of nice, isn't it, to soak up the light at least for a few moments. Or when you excel at sports or excel academically or accomplish something uplifting in the community and you receive an award or a scholarship or praise from others, it's nice to be recognized. It feels good to be recognized. And I can speak from a personal experience on this. When you're kids, years later, of course, happened to mention what a good job you did as a parent. It's wonderful to bask in the warmth and light of that acknowledgement. Light is good when it highlights the things we have done well, when it spotlights the times that we have worked hard, the times that we have succeeded. The light of the world feels welcome when it draws attention the good things, whether we did them or someone else did them. We like it when the light shines on things that are good because it encourages us, and sometimes it's a reward for us. In those cases, we embrace the light. We come to the light. Deeds that have been done in God should be affirmed, should be welcomed, and yes, should be imitated. Now, we talk about Jesus as being the light of the world, and Jesus is not difficult to love, at least most of the time. Oh, sometimes Jesus will rub us the wrong way. Or sometimes Jesus demands more of us than we think we are ready to give. But we see and we hear all of that in the context of the whole story of Jesus, the whole story of God's incredible, amazing love for us. In a very, very real sense, Scripture is dead on accurate when it says that we love because He first loved us. Jesus may be hard to understand sometimes. He may be hard to follow, but you know, He's not particularly hard to love. Yet, Jesus brings light into the world that exposes evil deeds, whether they are done by someone else or by us individually or by us corporately. We might want to say then, oh, Jesus, you know, please shine that light on others. But leave me alone. Leave me in the darkness. Leave me alone. You know, I believe there's a parable about seeing the specks in other people's eyes and somehow missing the log in our own. But this light of the world exposes not only others' evil, but the evil that is within us. The light of the world shines not only on the good that we have done, but also on the not so good we have managed to do along the way. And, you know, it seems entirely more logical to run and hide from such a light. So how do we learn to come to the light? How do we learn to emerge from darkness? Even though it means that all our deeds will be exposed. Part of the challenge we face, I think, is that we fear that God will be as judgmental and as unforgiving as we humans tend to be. We know we ourselves can be unforgiving at times, at least in certain people and or certain particular sins. So we pretty much expect the same thing from God. It seems to me, though, that the only way we can really learn to love that light and to lose our fear of it is to experience it from one another, to find our way into a community of faith where we can learn in a very real way, in a very real sense, that we are still loved. We are still loved. The light has come into the world, and we can welcome it, or we can hide from it. We can try to block it out for what it shows us about ourselves, or we can embrace it because it highlights what's good about us and offers us the opportunity of healing what is not. We can hide from it, hoping to keep all our secrets secret, or we can emerge from the darkness into it and work to reflect this light out to the rest of the world. We can be hiders from the light, or we can be bearers of the light for each other, for our community, for a world that sits mostly in darkness and truly needs illumination. See, God sent Christ into the world not to condemn the world, but to save the world, to shed light on us, not to condemn us, but to save us. So may we trust in that love. May we emerge from whatever darkness covers us into the light of that indescribable, unconditional love. May we share the love, the light of the world, Jesus Christ, through our words, through our actions, through our prayers. May we share that love with all of those who are still in darkness, who want to emerge from that darkness. May we be that instrument of God to share that love and to share that light of the world, Jesus Christ, to what we do, what we say. Thanks be to God. Join me for our next hymn, please. It is "What Wondrous Love Is This?"
Thank you.
Please join me as we say a statement of our belief, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Prayer of dedication for those gifts that have been mailed in and that you are continuing to mail in. Let us pray. O God of boundless love, you restore our strength through the faith in your goodness. You look with favor upon us and through Christ redeem us. You take not yourself from us, but promise your presence through the gift of your Spirit. You come from behind to push us and go before us as our guide. Accept now what we bring you in response to your encompassing care for us. Amen. Please now join with me in prayer. Relying on the promises of God, we pray boldly for the church, the world, and all in need. You sent your Son that the world might be saved through him. Inspire the witness of the church throughout the world. Empower missionaries, Bible translators, and ministries of service in your name. Bless all our partners in ministries, food pantries, clothing banks. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. From east to west, your steadfast love is shown. Nourish seas and deserts, wilderness areas and cities. Give water to thirsty lands. Nurture spring growth that feeds hungry creatures. Bless farmers as they prepare for the growing season. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. You sustained your people in the wilderness. Give courage to all who lead in times of crisis and scarce resources. Promise the work of those who aid victims of famine and drought. Bring peace in places where scarce resources cause violence. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Your mercy endures forever. Deliver all who cry to you, especially those who are hungry or without homes. Give life in places here death seems triumphant. Give healing to those who are sick and comfort to those who are mourn. Especially we lift up in prayer this day Curtis Bailey, Carson Barron, Kaylin Butler, Denise Campbell, Leanne Christina, Morris Demsko, Natasha Dermo, Carolyn Evans, Gabe Floria, Bernard Gilly, Paulette Gilly, Elmer Henry, Caitlin Hinckley, Jake Hinckley, Barry Hauser, Bernard Kammerdiner Jr., Tom Nolan, John Kowaleski, Austin Klein, Gail Loffman, Ken Maniak, Francis McHugh, Julie Meckes, Larry Meckes, Donald Miller, Earl Pratt, Ruth Raymond, Barbara Renninger, Harry Roush, Sally Roush, Stephanie Russell, Anne Marie Sassaman, Maisie Schock, Richard Shook, Curtis Steigerwald, Junior Steigerwald, Gene Schwartz, Abigail Troxel, Daniel Troxel, Christine Troxel, Kevin Tyson, Larry Zahner, Lisa Zahner, Aaron Zielinski, Rick Zielinski. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. By grace we have been saved. Fill this congregation to overflowing with that grace, that we show mercy to others, nourish any in our midst who are hungry, especially children, and bless our ministries of feeding and shelter. Give us patience and courage when the way seems long. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Your Son was lifted up so that whoever believes might have eternal life. We praise you for all you have died, for all who have died in Christ. Bring us with all the saints into the fullness of your promises. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now may we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn this day is The Old Rugged Cross. And now may the Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord's face shine on us with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon us with favor and give us peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.